So, good afternoon, everyone. So we, So good afternoon, you all. I hope you have enjoyed your meal today. I'm going to act as moderator in this plenary session two on structural funds in support of research infrastructures, synergies with cohesion policy, and the role of smart specialization strategies. I'm going to introduce myself. I'm Fernando Merida Martín from the Ministry of Economy and Competitiveness and the Secretary of State for Research, Development and Innovation. I would like to talk a little bit about the contents of this session. The main objective of this session is to provide a comprehensive view of how financial tools, such as the structural funds and the cohesion fund, can serve as financial option for research infrastructures, including details of their practical implementation at regional level and how this can be translated into the benefit for the whole project. Understanding of the need for research and innovation strategies for smart specialization, REACH3, is also included in this, under this section. The session is going to be divided in four blocks. The first one is going to have theoretical talks. A second one is going to talk about supporting tools and platforms available to support potential projects. A third one is going to be for examples of beneficiaries, and the fourth block is going to be reserved for debate and questions and answers. I'm going to introduce any of the speakers. I'm going to be very strict with the time allocated for each presentation, so we could reserve some space for the final debate. So I'm going to start with the first speaker. This is Katja Repel from the European Commission. He's deputy head of the unit in charge of the Competence Center for Smart and Sustainable Growth of the European Commission, Director General for Regional Policy. And she's responsible for ensuring consistency and synergies in the implementation of the structural funds in the current programming period with a view to smart growth, investment in research, innovation, competitiveness, ICT, and so on. So, Katja, the floor is yours.
So, thank you very much for giving me the occasion to participate in this interesting event. I meant to briefly touch on four points. The results from the past. As you might know, there were quite important investments from structural funds in research and innovation, and among them also in building up research infrastructures. A lot of that in the newer member states, but also in certain southern member states, the largest part of research infrastructure investments which took place was actually structural fund supported. A couple of lessons that we learned from this process and the conclusions that we drew from that, plus then of course, and that I think is the most interesting part for this conference, talk about the opportunities that are now open under the new structural funds programs which are out, and yes, also challenges, because it is not so simple to get that kind of funding. As you know from Horizon 2020, it's project-based, you need to apply. There are certain formalities to be respected, including painful issues such as state aid. Where are we after many years, many decades actually, of investment of structural funds in research and innovation? This is just a snapshot which puts the research innovation related investments a bit in a context. As you know, cohesion policy really is in a wider sense about socioeconomic cohesion, development, lagging region, declining industries, and so really a kind of investment program for jobs and growth. And you see, there was a very substantial number of research projects. Some of them were activities, as you now know them maybe from Horizon. Others are really research infrastructure projects. So in these over 100,000 research projects, there were lots of them research infrastructure. Cooperation projects, that is also something which takes place. So it is not only about giving individual research centers and firms money, it is also about having cooperation. And when you see these over 41,000 long-term research jobs created, that relates very largely to the number and the size and the quality of the research infrastructures that were set up thanks to cohesion policy funding. To look a little bit back, about 11.6 billion of the ERDF, the Regional Development Fund, this is one of the five funds that form the Structure and Investment Funds Group, 11.6 billion roundabout went into research infrastructures, and about half of that into the newer member states. And some of you might notice that still Germany, which, if you can read that, is number two in terms of the investment volume, being one of the founding members, there is still a very, very important, there was in 2007, 2013, very important investments in research infrastructures from structural funds as well. About 80 million of these 11.6 billion went, by the way, into cross-border projects. Most of the funding of structural funds is really country-specific or region-specific. And this is really sacrosanct, that whatever you invest maybe doesn't have to take place in a specific region or country, but it has to be for the benefit of that country or of that region. So pooling the money in European projects has its complications, let's say, apart from Interreg. And what you see here in these 80 million, these are Interreg projects where quite interesting investments took place. 32 of the many projects which were funded in the field of research infrastructures are what we call major projects. Major projects mean they were worth a lot more than 50 million each. Among them, also ELI. And you will see the investments in Hungary, Romania, and the Czech Republic, which I highlighted a little bit. A lot of them went into building up this S3 research infrastructure. What did we learn when doing these investments and looking a bit into the impacts? Well, one thing seemed to have been got lost somewhere on the way sometimes, that research excellence per se is not an objective of cohesion policy. It is about the socio-economic cohesion and about the economy in a wider sense. So, well, some of the projects were built a bit cathedrals in the desert. The other lesson that we learned is that big is not necessarily beautiful. It can be beautiful, but we also saw cases of overcapacities and cases where we're not quite sure that this is really the top crust type of investments which we would have liked to see. It became also clear to people just investing in a research infrastructure in a country or a region doesn't necessarily mean that you have a large socioeconomic impact in this. It only works if it is connected to the local innovation ecosystem. In order to connect that, knowledge and technology transfer to firms is absolutely essential and needed. Just to sit back and wait until companies are coming knock on the door won't work. That is something also which came out very clearly. We also saw that if you want to anchor these infrastructures in a region, if you want to make them also financially self-sustainable, then you need a business plan. And these business plans are, however, worth absolutely nothing unless they're really implemented. I've seen beautiful theoretical studies on how certain research infrastructures, by the way, also in Spain, could be used for developing the regional economy, which, to all that I know, have remained dead paper. Well, that doesn't help very much for cohesion policy. So it requires time and effort to really talk to the local enterprise world and get in touch with them, get out. And to do that, you need to plan to foster really from the outset. So when you conceive a project for research infrastructures, this should already take into account what is there in terms of market potential, innovation potential, technological needs, et cetera, that exist in a country or a region. And that pulls me through directly to the already frequently mentioned smart specialization, because that is exactly what we asked to do. Smart specialization strategies, my colleague will talk in a while about that, are essentially about integrated, knowledge-driven economic transformation to transform the local economic context. So into this, it has to fit in. There's a lot about transforming the industry with more knowledge. We asked all member states and regions, if they wanted, to develop such strategies to first do their footwork in terms of analysis. What do you have in terms of research strength, in terms of research infrastructure, capacities? What do you have in terms of industrial capacities, human capacities, natural environment assets, location assets, whatever? What do you have? What are your weaknesses also? And based on that, to pull in the stakeholders and talk to them, make them understand. Because if there is a lack of willingness to cooperate between the different actors, the brightest ideas and the brightest theoretical possibility for having their really strong point for smart specialization will not fly. Smart specialization also is about making choices. So you cannot fund everything everywhere. And not everybody needs to have a mini Silicon Valley or an aspiring biotech park. This was very popular in the last time round. It just won't fly. It needs to be adjusted to what takes place, and you need to really find out what are the strong points and what is missing in the territory. We also asked the member states and regions in the strategy development to have a broad look in innovation, not only technology-driven, social innovation, user-driven innovation, and so on. And all this accompanied by evaluation. Key and anchor point of the entire smart specialization process is the entrepreneurial discovery. And you see, from the outset, we already said you need to cooperate between business and research, and the public administration, and civil society, users, and so on, in order to come up with which are these potential fields of strength where you want to invest. And that was already quite challenging for some actors, both from the enterprise side and from the research side, to simply talk to each other, put the cards on the table, and find out what the other side is doing. Now, smart specialization is an ex-ante conditionality, as already mentioned this morning, so any investment from the Regional Development Fund into research innovation has to conform with that, in particular in our investment priority 1A, sorry about the technical language, which is about research infrastructures and capacities. These kind of investment priorities also have to come up with a second ex ante conditionality, a multi-annual plan for research innovation infrastructure, and on both of them, still, a number of member states and regions are working and have to do a bit of improvement. Now, what is a smart specialization priority? That comes up very, very frequently as a question. But it is not about picking a technology and not about picking a sector. It really is dynamic and forward-looking and trying to see where do I want to go next. What I put here is just an example. So there's a strength about ICT, energy, advanced manufacturing in a region. And they came to the point to say, let's do something on advanced manufacturing for energy-related applications in harsh environments. And there, really, they developed a vision where they want to get. They want to get into the international market. They want to decrease energy imports, and so on. And only then you get to the project level. And the project levels can be very, very specific for that field where you're in, can involve different enterprises, research institutes, and so on, classic type of research innovation activities, or it can also be research infrastructures, or more demonstration plants if you get closer to the market and the applicability. So how this should look like, the research infrastructures as part of a smart specialization strategy, well, it should really be an integral part of the roadmaps. These research infrastructure investments in their building up or expansion, development, should have come out in the entrepreneurial discovery process, so it should be known to the enterprises who are there. The research infrastructures should aim to become really a crystallization point for these transformations in the region. So the cooperation with local clusters, technology parks, incubators, and so on should be inbuilt into the concept. And also research infrastructures can be very attractive, when we decisive for attracting international talents and also international firms into a certain country or region, and could and should use this potential of international attractiveness also. And then anything, we want the smart specialization strategies also to be monitored. So this evaluation on how is it going now with our research infrastructures should be part of that. Now, when I say this is the ideal situations among us, the world isn't ideal, but many of them are aspiring to a good number of points. Maybe also Susanna has some observations on that. So the opportunities for the next round. Quite important money around for research and innovation. I took here an extract from the overall for all our five funds in the structural investment funds. And you see over 90 billion go into things which are related to research, innovation, ICT use, competitiveness, and really innovation drivers which are there, plus also important co-financing. Now, when I said in the beginning it's not that easy to get the structural funds, then please note that this sits in over 500 different operational programs, and each of them has its own managing authority. So in the next slides, when you see for countries like Poland, for Germany, for Spain, and so on, keep in mind, this is not a single block and not a single ministry, but you have to talk to each other among the different regions to get going and to influence what is happening. On the other hand side, if all of you are, your research infrastructures are located in a specific place. So there is definitely a local anchorage, and you might have the three or four programs which are interesting for you. A little bit of a breakdown for what is in the money. You will still see public research with 11 billion is quite strongly represented. In the public spending, you see a mix between public research infrastructures and the actual activities in the research infrastructures. And that is now a new slide. I made that yesterday, because it shows you the balance between this public research investments from the ERDF, where you can see that there is, in the blue bars, still a lot of research infrastructure investment around, but you see the red bar shows that there is more and more emphasis on using the existing infrastructures and actually filling them with life, and we're very, very happy to observe that. I mentioned major projects. We have an indicative list, so this will change, of major research infrastructures which are planned. Major infrastructure over 50 million each, as I can say, and to focus on what might be more interesting for the colleagues working on S3, also two of the S3 infrastructures are very explicitly mentioned in the operational programs. If it's not all mentioned, doesn't mean it cannot necessarily be financed, but it needs to be defined in the process of the implementation. Now, the challenges. Well, there are three. Getting from the programs and strategies actually to mature investment projects, align the research infrastructure plans to state aid, particularly the financing plans, and also make these research infrastructures work in the context of smart specialization. We heard already before from the EIB the investment possibilities. We'll hear more what is taking place. One of the things that is often overlooked is that many project designers are fantastic scientists, but they're not financial managers and not really involved into the setup of complex financial structures. So technical assistance, be it from Horizon 2020, of course it's called projects, and this evolves, helps the S3 projects to evolve, is available. Technical assistance from the Regional Development Fund for the major projects, JASPERS, it's by the way also DIB, which helps us implementing in that, helps to get on with cost-benefit analysis and coming up with a business plan for running and financing the research infrastructures. And last but certainly not least, it's a new thing, the EIB offers, as part of the European investment strategy, the European Investment Advisory Hub. And there we're talking really about the bankability of projects. The question which personally I have is this all fitting perfectly together? Well, I can only ask project developers to have a certain timeline in their mind and see where do they stand. When it comes to the major projects of the ERDF, I can tell you there is lots of support available in Jaspers, and it all goes about cost-benefit. There's actually a guide about cost-benefit, which we issued, which is available, and the guide has a very clear perspective also on long-term versus medium to short-term. So the cost-benefit is looked at in a certainly 30 years perspective, so you don't have to say at the end of 5 years it has to carry itself financially. This is not the purpose. But within the 7 years duration of the operational programs of the ERDF, there should be certain things which are clarified and which come out. Very interesting to read if you're conceiving that. Well, conceiving the project also means looking into the issue of state aid. And many people shy away from that because the notification process is difficult. There are, however, a number of possibilities not to notify. In particular, if only 20% of a project is dedicated to economic activities. And there, let me stress, whatever the Regional Development Fund funds is for social economic development. So there has to be an economic activity in this. This cannot stay just fundamental research completely aloof. There has to be a perspective of having an economic use for that. But anyway, it doesn't have to go all up to 20%. It's not even considered as a state aid if there's public financing coming to an institute. There's also possibilities under the general block exemption to conceive the project funding in a way that the public funding and ERDF is fully counted as public funding, stays under the aid intensity threshold so that a notification isn't necessary. And my last point really is how to make this, the actions of research infrastructures, which are sketched out in this ideal, how it could work, an ideal slide, how could that work? I mean, what could member states and regions do? One thing really is to prioritize strategic and transformative projects in the risk re-implementation, in the selection criteria, which now by and by coming out, and to foresee there that also the research infrastructures fit into this drive towards the SWAT socialization priorities. The other issue is about overcoming fragmentation and also duplication, and really to get critical mass out. I mentioned before briefly the S3 infrastructure project, the ESS and the ELI projects. It is possible to use certain amounts of structural funds outside the territory. Not quite easy, it has to be clearly for the benefit of the paying region or member state, but it could be done. When you think a little bit smaller projects, also there, the regulations allow to at least coordinate what each other is doing. And to start off with doing this, a mapping of what is there, what is needed, is really a good starting point. I finish with a practical example because I was thrilled to see that some regions have already done that. In the so-called Vanguard initiative, not paid by the Commission, they teamed up 20 plus regions. They looked into what are the smart specialization priorities of the other member states and regions. And with going around it, they found out that they all have a certain interest from different angles to push 3D printing. Said, aha, that's good. Let's get together and work it out. And they started with a mapping exercise. And the mapping exercise resulted in effect that certain regions who had planned to pay for certain demonstrators and so on actually will not do that because they realized that other regions have already such demonstrator plans and facilities and they don't need to duplicate that. So really, this is the way I would warmly recommend to go ahead. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Katia, for your very interesting presentation. We are going now to the second presentation that is going to be done by Susana Elena Perez. She is a researcher and expert in European projects dealing with research and innovation policies, smart specialization strategies, transnational research and development program collaboration, finance and governance in universities, and other things. And since 2008, she works as scientific officer at the Institute for Prospective and Technological Studies from GRC. Well, she is going to make a presentation she's going to make a presentation. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here. And I'm going to talk about the smart specialization strategies. This is something that we work at the GRC, in the Institute for Prospective and Technological Studies, is located in Seville. And we work directly with DG Rio, and actually we work directly with Katia and her team. So what I'm going to do is to explain a bit more in detail what she already mentioned on the smart specialization strategies and why we have to talk about this in this type of forum. So I'm sure that all of you are already aware and familiarized with the concept of smart specialization strategies, but I think it's worthy to spend a second to distinguish some of the concept and terminology that we use from the Commission side, and it's not always crystal clear for all the audience, the difference between the different acronyms, and I think is really the moment to start understanding the concept in the right way. So what is a smart specialization? Katia explained what is called the policy concept, what we name S3. So this, as Katia said, is a policy oriented to promote inclusive and sustainable growth, and is mainly based on valorizing the existing assets and the specificities of the different territories. And it's based in a concept called entrepreneurial discovery process, so that it's really a bottom-up approach. And it implies a prioritization of the elements to be part of the actual strategy. So it means that we need to take a risk and to set a limited number of strategy. This is S3, the policy concept. We also have the risk 3, which is actually the strategy itself. It's what the regions and the member states develop, design, and now are in the process of implementation. Okay, so this is, I'm sure you were part of some of the discussions and you already read and are aware of the implementation in your region or your country. And that's why we refer to RIS3 as the strategy itself. I will later on, in the part devoted to support and tools, talk about the S3P, which is actually the smart specialization platform. So I just want to be sure that we talk about the same concept using the same terminology. So what's new? I mean, I'm not going to stop a lot here because already Katia mentioned it's not really a neutral policy. This is the main change. What is new is that we need to set up priorities, and this means that we need to assume risk. We need to clarify what are the strengths and weaknesses in our territories. We need to know the territories, and we need to set up this bottom-up approach involving all the main stakeholders from the quadruple helix. This, even in this implementation phase in which we are now, is a permanent and a continuous, a dynamic process. We need to incorporate the views on the different stakeholders in the process in a dynamic. It's something that it shouldn't be taken as done. We put check, we did it, and that's all. We need also to monitor the strategies, to engage the stakeholders at all stages, and very importantly, in the implementation phase. So it's something that is persistent in time, and it's something that you from the different institutions, as scientists, as researchers, as part of the ministries, as part of the territorial and the local government, need to be aware that this is a dynamic process. So if we take into consideration the moment in which we are now, we can see, we know that most of the regions and countries are already in the implementation phase. What we saw analyzing all the different smart specialization strategies from the different regions and countries all across Europe is that RIS3 are generally quite good in terms of analysis of the assets and the specificities of the territory, but they are a bit weaker in terms of monitoring and evaluation. So this is something that in the implementation phase it become a crucial issue. So I think here is also a good moment to incorporate monitoring and evaluation in our mindset from the very beginning of the process. Also, we understand that the S3 principles are not fully taken into consideration since it still need to be at least a limited set of priorities. We saw many, many strategies which actually are including almost everything in the priority, which actually is not the aim of a priority setting. And again, this is something that is continuous, and we need to take into consideration that the process is there, and we are in this implementation phase, and we are part of these actors. Of course, we have still a lot of challenges in front. First, we need to preserve this bottom-up approach. We really think this is an ideal way of decision-making process, incorporating all the stakeholders, and we need to take into consideration all the agents and all the actors in this process, and of course, to incorporate more and more, not only the triple helix model, but also the quadruple helix. In this context, also Katia mentioned why we are here talking about smart specialization in a symposium that is devoted mainly to research infrastructures. Well, research infrastructure should be part of the priority list and should be part of the smart specialization strategy of the country or the region. And it should be identified and designed not from the top down, but from the bottom up. So all the members that are here should have a word to say in what type of research infrastructure the territory needs. And also it should be designed, and this is something that Katia mentioned, but I want to reinforce the idea that it should not be a cathedral in the desert. We need really to build something with economic impact and socioeconomic impact in the territory. So when I was preparing the presentation, the organizer really enforced the idea that we have to be practical. So I was thinking how we can show some examples of what is really happening and what are the real cases and the real information you can take from this symposium back home and use it. So among the themes and areas in which the Smart Specialization Platform is working is the digital growth. This morning was mentioned the importance of the ICT infrastructures as mainly a precondition for territorial development. So we have the GRC together with DigiDigit started a process, a project jointly to understand what are the ICT priorities and what are the ICT infrastructures planned in all the regions in Europe. So in our website, that here you have the window, you can use a digital agenda toolbox where you have different subsections, among others, e-infrastructure or living labs or the cloud computing on the next generation networks. You can filter, you can look for what is there, what are the main objectives, the description of the task, and what is happening in other regions in Europe. And this is very important because for the priority setting, you need first to know, obviously, what is really happening and what is already there to build on there and to collaborate with other regions. Also, as a monitoring tool, you can use this search is not completely clear, but there is a search engine in which you can select the different countries and regions, and you can filter depending on the area of digital growth, and you can see the planned ICT investment and the receipt for all the regions in Europe. Okay, so I think it's really a powerful tool, and I think it's useful for you to have in mind what is already there and how you can contribute with your from your institute. We also produce documents, reports based on our specialized workshops in our peer reviews. I just give you a couple of titles from the most recent ones on the digital agenda. And of course, everything is online, and you can access to all the documents. And if you have any other questions, you can always send us an email, and we will be glad to send you the document. So, synergies, the big title here, and we always talk about the famous synergies. So when we talk about synergies, everybody is asking us, okay, tell us the recipe, how we can do it. The Commission should say, okay, you can do it this way. Okay, there is no a recipe. We don't have all the answers. There is a guide in which DigiRio work intensively, where you have some options and some theoretical framework, a legal framework to do that. But of course, you have different ways to do it, and you have to put it in place. So our effort during the last year was to try to identify case studies, real cases where you can see that the synergy is there. We were just commenting in the corridor that when we talk about synergies in some cases, and depending on the audience, we think about co-funding, which is not exactly the same. So when we talk about synergies, it's actually putting together different funds to expand the impact of the research and innovation project. So in the context of the Smart Specialization Platform, we are also working in a project called Estherway to Excellence, which is mainly oriented or targeting EU 13 countries. And we, as I said, devoted a lot of time to analyze real synergies. So we produce a list of case studies. We have 25 published online case studies. Here you have the complete table. It is organized depending on the theme, so if it's about environment, on energy, or it's about nanotech, the type of synergies following the structure of the guide, the guide on synergies. If it's sequential, if it's parallel, if it's upstream, if it's downstream. Also, you have information, obviously, about the country which is implementing this, and the example. In this, with a click, you have the whole document, and I also have a print version of each of them, so if you want to have a look how they look like, I will be happy to give you the document. So this was really an exhaustive work. Some of them are produced internally by the IPTS colleagues and by myself, and others are produced or were produced by external experts. I just would like to focus on a couple of them just for you to have an idea of what do we mean by these case studies on synergies. I want to show you one example that will be explained later, and is the TEC, which is a research center. It's a scientific consortium based in or located in South Moravia in the Czech Republic, and is mainly working in the fields of science, life science, and advanced material and technologies. And it was funded approximately with 3,000 million euros, 85% coming from structural funds and OP and the OP on research and development for innovation. And the idea was to create top facilities for top researchers, and also to create the scientific environment to attract other researchers. If we follow the categories, we will see that it's combined upstream, meaning building capacity, and downstream, meaning commercializing the innovation, the results of the research, and also sequential funding. If you go through the document, you will see is not, yeah, I think it's more or less, you will see different type of diagrams, mainly two. One diagram on the chronology of the main projects involved in the synergy, because obviously we cannot create synergies from one day to another. We cannot create synergies from today to tomorrow. And this is a process that is built on a strategic view, is built on mission purpose, and is built on a generation. It's not, we need to do it in a really in a strategic manner. So you can see here how they started with the research infrastructure in 2007, and then they found it partially with the OP, and then you can see how this facilitates the framework program capacity of this research center to work in projects of the FP7. Now they also are having an NERACHER with Horizon 2020, and also some ERC grants. So as you can see, this is an example of synergy, but it's not an example of synergies completely parallel, it's not completely sequential, it's a combination of everything. It goes from upstream to downstream, and it was built during years. You have another way of visualizing this, and you have research, training, and innovation, and you can see where research infrastructure is, and the rest of the project, so it's the same information organized in a different way. And also we have, and this is the final slide, this is another example among these 25 that you can have a look. It's a collaboration between the European Maritime Energy Center and CENSIS, the Innovation Center for Section and Sensor and Imaging System. This is based in Scotland, and this collaboration started in 2015. It's also upstream and downstream, and it's sequential and also parallel. So you can see here the main projects involved. You can see how they build their own projects and how they collaborate, and how these build capacity and also make these research centers and scientists more able to win in a competitive project, Horizon 2020. In here, you can see also the same information with the different projects. And this is all that I have to say. Just to invite you to go through the case studies, I think it's a very singular information, and how these synergies are built in different contexts, in different regions, in different countries, but also to have the idea that this is a process that takes time and a strategic view. Thank you.
Thank you, Susana, for your interesting presentation on the platform activities. Now we are going to move to the third presentation that is going to be made by Moisés Blanco Maceiras. He is currently Deputy Vice Director General for European Territorial Cooperation in the Spanish Ministry of Finance and Public Administration. He has been involved in maritime and transport affairs in different areas such as quality management, policy making, strategic planning, and now he's dealing with the management of financial and cooperation mechanisms of the European Economic Area and the European Union in Spain. And he is the Spanish National Representative for Interreg Europe. So we say 15 minutes.
Thank you, Fernando. Hello to everybody. First time when I received the invitation by RITS Consortium to present you the Interreg Europe program, I thought what was the match in between research infrastructure and S3 with this program. And actually, during these first sessions, I realized that it's really, really a big match. I want to just highlight some words that were heard here. Monsieur Philippe Frossard, he talking the welcoming words about the stakeholders group and action plans for research infrastructures and financing. El señor Octavio Quintana, he told us about research must be useful for policy making. This is exactly the message of Interreg Europe adapted for research infrastructures. So we are going to talk about policy making, policymakers, and the service to the society, and that is the main goal of Interreg Europe program. So any action from you to this problem should be addressed to this goal of improving the policy making work or the policies that are implemented in your regions. Also, Mr. Burgueño, he presented the European data infrastructure that would have some kind of parallelism with our policy learning platforms, as you will see. And more recently, Ms. Katia Reppel, she told us about the connection, the needed connection to innovation ecosystem. This problem is also more focused to maybe innovation than to research, so to get real change in the ecosystems. Ana, Senora Susana Elena, told us about the synergies and to expand the effect of the funds. This is the well-known leverage funds that is also a core idea in Interact Europe. We are a small program in terms of funding, but with a huge leverage effect, since we are acting directly with the public authorities that are supposed to implement the structural funds. And in particular, talking about RIS, RIS 3, our platforms are kind of evolution, or are based on the idea of the best practice of the RIS 3 Andalucía and Seville. So I'm here as national representative for this Interreg Europe program. It's one of the several Interreg programs that Katia told us before, and with the particularity that it's not national or trans-border, but covering the whole Europe, 28 member states, plus Norway and Switzerland. I'm going to present you the key features of this program. In terms of reference, that would be really short, and the support tools by the Joint Secretariat, which are more addressed to the people that are really on the work for applying for this program. First of all, I would say that we are now with an open call, the second call of the program, but we are quite ahead with the times, because it's closing on 13th of May. So quite on the edge to go for this call this time. At the same time, as main point, this is the principle, the most of the biggest call in the program in terms of funding availability. So you may, if you are able to go for it, it could be the momentum. Let's start with the key features about this program. The objectives set in the ETC, ETC is a European Territorial Cooperation Regulation, that is the first time in this period, 2014-2020, that ETC has its own regulation. So it's press the focus of the European Commission on these policies. The objectives are to reinforce the effectiveness of cohesion policy and to foster the investment for growth and jobs goal, but also in the cooperation programs themselves. This slide goes with the idea of the leverage of funds. If we see the whole picture of the cohesion policy, we have 340 billion euro for the period 2014-2020. For ETC, European Territorial Cooperation, we have 10.2 billion. And this program, Interreg Europe, is only 359 million, of which we have 2,060, almost two-thirds of the funds available during this second call. If we talk about the geographical coverage, as I advanced, we have the whole European Union territory, plus Norway and Switzerland. Talking about thematic of the program, we have four thematic objectives, or thematic axes, that are research and innovation. That would be the most important one for you, but also SME competitiveness, environment and resource efficiency, and low carbon economy. I'm going to focus only on the first thematic axis, since it should be the most interesting one for the forum. And the first axis is, it has two parts, but the first one, specific objective 1.1, is directly related to, or is the same than the investment priority 1A that Katia presented us before. So it's research and innovation infrastructure for smart specialization strategies. Who can apply? Who are the players of this program? The main focus are for managing authorities. So they are regional, local authorities that are in charge whether of the structural funds or their local or regional ERDF programs, but also is open for agencies, institutes, and any other non-profit organization. The objective is to change knowledge, so not to invent the wheel, but look for anyone that has a good will. So the idea is that all around Europe, you are going to find for sure any other region that has had the same problem that you have now, and they have faced it already, and they have a good experience, they have a best practice. So the key in this program is to look for the right partnership and look for the same organizations or equivalent organizations that can make a knowledge exchange with you. You have to give something and you will receive something. There is not a one direction program, but you have to be in two directions and giving your part or giving your knowledge as well. Here you have some examples of some target groups for the objective 1.1. And some examples of projects that could be covered under this specific objective. You have all the information in the webpage of the program. You will have all the possible partners or the interested people in a big community in this webpage. And you can look for one side for the manual, for the information. For the other side, you can look for the partners to your trip. If we take a quick view about what was the results of the, what were the results of the first call in Spain, we have just approved the projects, but we can say that objective, specific objective 1.1, that would be the most interesting for you, is underrepresented in Spain. Only two partners have succeeded or have applied for this kind of projects. I'm talking about the kind of organizations that are taking part. Most of them, almost 60%, are public authorities or similar to public, and only 7% is private non-profit organizations. That is also maybe because it's the first time that private non-profit organizations are included in the program. So it's new, and we have 7% involvement of these kind of organizations. As I said before, this is a program for a change of knowledge. So not only you have a project, you get some results, some outcomes, but you have to make this information to go forward at the organizational level, at the regional stakeholders learning, and even more difficult, but external and EU level learning. So the influence has to come from the bottom to top and have to influence in any policy that are dealing with your issues, with the themes where you are working on. How can you improve a policy that could be looks hard, difficult, almost impossible, but you have the possibility of implementing projects. You can change the program governments. You can change the program content. And for the two last ones, you may not require funding. That's also another leverage effect of this program. What kind of actions are we looking for in this program? We have two different actions, projects and policy learning platforms. Policy learning platforms are the ones that I told before that came from the RIS3 in Seville and have some similarities with the European data infrastructure. They are still starting now, so we don't have any experience still on that. They are supposed to start their services after summer, around September. But projects. Projects, we have already a call, a very successful call for Spanish partners, indeed. And if we talk about how does it work, we look for a limited number of regions. The advice from the program is to have between 5 to 10 partners from different regions all around Europe. Thank you, Fernando. You have two phases. This is really, really important. You have a first phase that is a change of knowledge. So you are going to look for the best practice and you are going to give your part to that. And you have to develop in the first 2 to 3 years an action plan. This action plan is going to be implemented during the next 2 years, but during the last 2 years, you don't have the funding from this program to the implementation. You only have the money for the monitoring. So it's a results-oriented program. You have to develop a real action plan and a real action plan that you are going to implement. Otherwise, you couldn't finalize it during the last 2 years. Sorry. This is information about what kind of organizations. You can go deeply in the web page. I'm going to go a little bit quicker since I'm running out of time. About financing, this is interesting for sure for you. You have for public institutions, you have 85% of 85% of ERDF funds. For private nonprofit, 75%. The other ones are not used here in Spain. This is the national contact point in Spain. You can find it whether in our DG Community Funds webpage or in the interreg-europe.eu webpage. And you will ask any question about the national nurture of this of the partners. This is something also specific for those that are interested in applying. Three countries, partners coming from three countries at least, and at least two of them from EU member states and financed by Interreg Europe program. The lead partner may be from EU member state or Norway, and as a remark in the first call, Spain was the leader in a number of lead partners in projects approved. So there's a will in a public sector in Spain to learn and to do the best practices as possible. The platforms, as I said, they are still developing, so you have all the information in the presentation that you will have, and if any question, please ask us. In terms of reference, for those that could fit on this program, you have the open second call until the 13th of May. You have the very useful support tools from the Secretariat, and you have the biggest budget in this program this time, and all the priorities are open. If you want to have a schedule on the time, as you asked before to some of the speakers, you have around 10 months from the application to the start of the project. The support tools, they are wide, they are really useful, and they are all of them in interregeurope.eu that I advise you to visit if you are interested. So thank you very much for your patience.
Thank you, Moises, for the presentation on Interreg. And we come back again to Susanna for her second presentation.
Hello again. This is part of the support and advice service, so I want to talk about the S3P, the Smart Specialization Platform. Okay? I'm not going to give you a lot of background. You will already have the presentation, but it just was created in 2011. Is run actually in the GRC and the IPTS in Seville in collaboration with DG Regio, and also in the steering committee. Other DGs are taking part of the process and part of the committee. It's a privileged perspective what we have, because we, from the outside the Commission, we support countries and regions in designing and implementing the smart specialization process. From inside the Commission, we also support different DGs so that everything has a more coherent and coordinated way. And also, we are in touch with the scientific community. We are also researchers, and we produce documents and papers in a more conceptual and methodological way. I'm going to go a bit fast with this. I just wanted to see that the platform is voluntary, so there is no obligation for any region to be part of the platform. However, we have now a wide membership. 162 regions and 18 countries are part of them. Of the platform, and there is for this initiative a very high-level endorsement at EU level from the European Commission, from the European Parliament, from the Committee of the Regions, and from the Council. We have a quite high fidelization rate in terms that more than 50% of the regions that participate in one of the activities that we organize, they repeat. They want to come back and they want to be part of another activity. We, as I said, produce scientific outputs, and the website, you will have a knowledge repository with different conceptual notes, policy briefs, and articles on the concepts and the rationale behind this process. Just to give you an idea of the policy impact of the ST platform in terms of the peer review, we can say the impact rate, 80% of the respondents, once we finalize the peer reviews, thought that it was an interesting exercise. 50% of the respondents agreed that participating in that workshop or in that peer review introduced changes in the way they were actually defining the smart specialization strategy, and 80% agreed that it made them to change significantly their definition or the way they were working in the smart specialization strategies. So how do we work? We work in different sections. We do work directly with specific actors, with universities, with research and technology organizations, with science parks, with SMEs. We work on the process, on the governance process. We work on monitoring and evaluation system, and we work particularly on the entrepreneurial discovery process. We also provide target support, for instance, through different projects in rural innovation. What I mentioned before, the Stairway to Excellence project that is targeting EU 13 countries, or the RENT project, which is targeting one particular region, East Macedonian Thrace in Greece, and is going to enlarge their scope and work on other lagging regions. We work also in different themes in terms of fields. We have an S3P platform in energy. We work, as I said before, in digital growth, in KEDS, in value change. And we also work in a smart specialization from a transnational or transregional point of view in terms of collaboration. We have activities on the Danube area and the Baltic Sea region and the Atlantic Arc. One of the most useful things that you can actually use immediately when you are, even now from your seat, is to go to the tools. You will have the option to compare, to benchmark different regions. There is, and actually in the presentation you have the direct link to the regional benchmarking tool. You also have an iRIS3 tool, which gives you the different priorities of the different regions, so you can compare, you can see what regions are doing what, and what are the priorities of the different regions, to see what are the ways you can collaborate better, and also to set up your own priorities. And you also have a tool in interregional trade flows. You can use it directly, and I think it's very important for your knowledge in terms of what neighbors and regions are doing, other countries or other participants. In this project, as I said, which is part of the Smart Specialization Platform, that's the way to excellence, we focus on supporting new member states actually to bridge the gap and assist these countries in the creation or the promotion of synergies. We organize national events and in these different countries, and you have plenty of information of each national event that you can check in your own country and see all the presentations, the programs, or the ones that are going to be in the following months. You also have quantitative and qualitative information at national and regional levels and level in all these countries, and we have produced country facts and figures and regional facts and figures. And in terms of structural funds and FP7 and data. You also have, as I mentioned before, all the case studies, real case studies in which SIF and Horizon 2020 or structural funds and framework program are actually combined, and you have a complete document on that. And you have also other instruments, platform and activities in the downstream area. I don't want to make it very long, so please go to the website, navigate, try to use the tools, try to see in which situation you region are, how you can compare yourself with others, and anything that you need, we are, of course, available for you anytime. You have all the websites here. Also, we produce a monthly newsletter, and we have also a Twitter account, and we are available for you anytime. So, thank you.
Thank you, Susanna, for being so brief, because we are a little bit bad on time. Next speaker is Mr. Schaller, Michael Schaller. He works as Senior Product Engineer in the Jaspers Directorate of the European Investment Bank. Jaspers provides technical assistance in different sectors, aiming at the preparation of projects that are eligible for co-financing from the US structural funds. So please, Mr. Schaller.
Thank you for the introduction. So I see that we are around, I think we're three people here from the EIB, so you can see our commitment to research and development. Specifically, I will talk about JASPERS, which is an instrument for technical assistance, which has been in place basically since 2006. And I will focus on R&D. Normally, this is a topic that would require well more than 10 minutes, but I try to squeeze it in as much as possible. So I'll start with the basics, and will work my way down then to R&D and the specificities of that. JASPERS, the acronym means joint assistance to the support of to support projects in European regions. Basically, it came online in 2006. It's a technical assistance between today three main partners: the European Commission, European Investment Bank, and EBRD. The reason for it was that when the new member states, those that joined after 2004, started to send in applications for structural funds funding, it became evident that the quality of the projects was not very good and they did not have the experience of presenting and conceiving projects and projects plans. So hence, after some thinking, this partnership came was launched. Physically, we are, administratively, we are actually under the European Investment Bank. We are EIB employees. Main office is in Luxembourg, but we also have branch offices in Brussels, Vienna, Warsaw, and Bucharest. This is for historical reasons, because our main activities in the previous program period was in the new member states at that time. So the technical assistance is mainly, this has changed a bit, but it's still mainly targeted at structural funds, projects, R&D projects in your case, that can profit from co-findings from EU funds, structural funds. JASPERS is today, again, a three-tier organization. The main bulk is the advisory services, which I represent. We also have something new, which is the independent quality review, which helps the Commission to screen projects and give opinions of the quality for them, with the objective of easing the approval process. We also have the networking platform and competence center, which is a mechanism for collecting lessons learned, distribute and disseminate information, and arrange workshops on all kinds of topics, stated, environmental, CBA training, and whatever. What is very good to know is that the JASPERS is the advice that they provide is completely voluntary. Nobody is obliged to take it into account. However, as a result of the work we do, we normally write a report which is committed with, which is sent with the application. And this is normally of quite high importance for the Commission when they take a decision. Even more importantly is that our assistance is free. So if you know the expression, there's no such thing as a free lunch, that does not apply to us, because all expenses are covered by the three partners. At large, the advisory services are in covering different sectors. It started out with waste, and then wastewater, and then also energy and solid waste came online. Later also rail and maritime and roads. Smart developments, which is the division which I'm working for, which also includes R&D, came officially as a division a bit later, around 2010, when the need became more and more evident. Today we are around 120 staff, engineers and economists, but we also have experts in state aid and environmental issues. Since the start, around 2006, I would say around 1,000 completed assignments have been concluded. 498 major projects have been submitted to the Commission, and 467 in January 2016 have been also approved. Statistically, we have been able to show that involving JASPERS normally speeds up the approval process, and it definitely increases the quality of the documentation, which is well seen by the Commission. And it also shortens the timeline. Going down to research and development. To get our assistance, we normally would like to see that a research project eligible for cooperation or for assistance is listed in one of the national operational programs for support for structural funds. Ideally, we work with major projects. That's projects of the size of 50 million euros. But we have also seen that those are less frequent now compared to the previous program period. So we also, on a selective basis, are happy to work on non-major projects. There's still a theoretical threshold of 20 million euros. Horizontal assignments are quite frequent as well. That could be, I'll give more examples later on, but typically workshops, training of CBA, environmental issues, or strategy reviews, for instance, small specialization strategies. As I said, it's the target is for structural funds. They're targeted also to provide high quality documentation to ease the approval, because the guidelines for the application forms and the documents that are supposed to be sent to the Commission are quite cumbersome and demanding, and require at least feasibility studies today and a well in filled in application form. So we normally. With some exceptions, we would focus on the feasibility study, which is then translated into the application form. Focus is on social economic impact, and there we also have been able to draw some lessons learned based on the previous program period. We look at the technical feasibility to see if it's a sound project. We do not pretend to be experts. We have technical knowledge, but we respect that those people that run the projects, they have wide more competence in that sector than us. But we are, however, available to check out deficiencies in some technical areas. Optionality is very, very important. Or the other implementation options for a project that we are looking into as well, together with the beneficiaries. Demand, also very important, because we have to be sure that the product that is going to be in the R&D sector is not, by the end of the day, a white elephant, which is a fancy house, a fancy infrastructure, but there's no actual demand from the research side. Financial economic analysis, this would be the cost and benefit analysis, which is a very, very important exercise as well. We have together, Jaspers, with the Commission, contributed extensively to the new CBA guidelines, and I dare to say that we have pretty good expertise in that area as well, both in the financial analysis and economic analysis, and which we can always help the beneficiaries with. Risk assessment is a part of any sound project, of course. And we also look into the environmental soundness of the project, and we check if there are any state aid issues that needs to be highlighted. Important to know is that we do not prepare the projects, we don't write the projects, but we provide advice on how the project should be conceived. And then it's up to the beneficiary to take that into account. Going down to my particular division, the Smart Development Division, we cover a number of areas, contrary to the other sectors or divisions I mentioned. RDI is one important area, but also ICT, health, education, culture, urban development, in the broad sense of the term, and integrated multi-sectoral projects, which will then be smart cities, for instance. Small error here, because I wrote 108 R&D assignments, which is not correct. It should be today we have completed 108 assignments in total, and of those, 22 are major projects in R&D, research and development. At present, we have 23 projects, R&D projects, in the portfolio which we're working on. These are major, non-major, and horizontal assignments in different proportions. So, coming back to horizontal assignments, what could that be, for instance? That would be assistance in preparation of elevation criteria. So to help on the national side to select sound projects, screening of projects to see if these can be better be grouped, instead of having 10 small projects to have one big project, instead of 10 minor projects having one major project, for instance. We review policies, methodologies, smart specialization, and I'm coming back again to the cost-benefit analysis, which normally is very useful for any of our beneficiaries. We arrange workshops in a number of topics, CBA I mentioned, environmental issues and state aid. Some examples of RDI projects. ELI has been discussed today, that's one of our flagship projects. Very interesting one, and under implementation now, it has been completely approved, and also we are working on the second phase approvals of these projects. Sesamat, it's a project in Poland for advanced materials and technologies, CENT 3, IT for innovations, National Center for Physical and Technological Sciences, research infrastructure in Croatia, for instance. This is an example of a minor project. SATEC was mentioned before, and I believe that you have been involved in that as well as an example. Okay, interesting. So, how is the way to get our assistance? So, as I said in the beginning, we're more targeted to the older member states, but now, as in this program period, we have a mandate which covers all EU countries and EPA countries. A partnership agreement has to be signed. Examples of new member, old member countries will be France, Greece, Italy, and also Turkey as an example of an EPA country. We are active in all these countries. Support, you can talk to me, or the national authorities or project promoters can also initiate everything, but it has to go through the national managing authorities. Important is that, as I said, we are very focused on the structural funds, but the new mechanism for the Juncker plan, the FC, has put this advisory hub in place. Requests can also go in through the advisory hub, and we can provide assistance also then to projects which are non-structural fund projects, but they're going through another path, and finally they come to us, they go to our other EIB colleagues, depending on what kind of project it is. You'll find more information here, and I believe there will be a separate session on the advisory hub as well, which can be very useful. So I think that was the very short version. I'm happy to continue another 40 minutes, but I think I ran out of time, so thank you very much.
Thanks a lot for the presentation. Now we are moving to the third block, and we are going to start with the presentation by Juan Miguel González Aranda. He has a degree in telecommunication engineering and a European PhD and master in industrial organization and enterprise management. He is the head of area of nanomaterials and e-science at the Ministry of Economy and Competitiveness, being supervisor of the participation of the Spanish research and infrastructure in diverse international initiatives on e-science. And he also coordinated Spanish participation in LifeWatch, an e-science European infrastructure for the biodiversity and ecosystem research. So the floor is yours. 10 minutes.
I see. So thank you very much, Fernando. Thank you very much to the organizers for inviting me. So, you know, I'm an expert on ICT, so I must wait. It's used to happen. Maybe it's open here. I think this is. Yes, this is the one. Thank you so much. So, as Fernando told us before, I'm going to explain a sample of beneficiary based on LightWatch. So, my presentation is divided in three parts. First of all, I will try to be very brief and make an introductory context based on what is LightWatch. LightWatch in a nutshell. So, LightWatch is free, European Strategy Forum on Research Infrastructure, for this acronym, is a pan-European science distributed infrastructure focused on how to measure the impact of global change issues on Earth, biodiversity, and ecosystem research. So, it's easy to do with ecosystems, scale, species, time and evolution, DNA, proteins, genomics. So, LifeWatch addresses the big environmental challenges and support knowledge-based strategic solutions to environmental preservation. We are talking about biodiversity ecosystem functioning, climate change, habitat fragmentation loss, species invasive, alien species, compound impacts. So, we are talking about the big five, the hottest ecological topics, and as well the challenges related with the study of the Earth as a single complex and coupled system. So, LightWatch is tackling with complexity, and complexity of big scientific and societal biodiversity, societal very important, by the way, it's important to remark this, challenges that requires big data analysis from many regions, and distributed origins, resources. So, this mission is mainly achieved by providing access to a multitude of data sets, services, and tools, enable the construction and operation of virtual research environments, which provide environments for integrating data, software, and computation as developed in European infrastructure cooperation. Well, I love this cube. Maybe you can read very well, but you can see that the ICT part is very important because it's a main tool, a transversal component that is supporting to three main sets of users with their own rules. We're talking of managers and decision makers, not only researchers themselves, as well citizens in general terms. We're talking about the right to work environment, for a water framework directive. We're talking about river basin restoration, for risk management, and how to provide ecosystem management and an ICT reference model for dealing with the biodiversity ecosystem functioning and their associated applications. So, second part, moving from satellite projects contributions to the construction of a pan-European distributed and federated infrastructure, as if LifeWatch case study, because there are, we are not starting from scratch. We are starting from many, many initiatives, and I will not read all of them, but LifeWatch is cooperating with distributed centers in cooperating countries, including the regions. The regional component is very important. These centers are developing and operating virtual and physical media and other components. We are talking about a common infrastructure and several distributed centers. This common infrastructure is mainly based in Amsterdam, in the Netherlands, in Regione Puglia, in Lecce, in Italy, as well in Andalusia region, where the ERIC will be hosted, mainly the status seat, as well the ICT infrastructure coordination and management of construction and their operations. So, but not only, because in LifeWatch we are happy to announce that we are, 8 countries has just have just confirmed their participation as full members, and there are many regions involved here, many that are eligible, that can apply for structural funding. So I would like here to also inform you that this started May 12, 2014 in the DigiConnect unit, Infrastructure Connect, with the organization of a very interesting workshop on the use of structural funds for the construction of distributed infrastructure support environmental initiatives, because as many of our colleagues told us before, we cannot reinvent the wheel and we cannot again and again repeat the initiatives, but create synergies based on the ICT transversality. And this stress was reflected in the attendance to this workshop of over 80 persons from 15 countries and over 20 regions. And there are some followed by some publications on the use of structural funds. A very interesting publication of this regard was based in between Italy, among Italy, Portugal, and Spain regional cooperation results. We're talking that LifeWatch is based in intermediary agreements because these participating countries have not only in cash, but in kind contributions. And many of these in kind contributions have been developed based on structural funds. And we're talking about that we are talking about a realistic construction on associated business plans. That is very important to consider, including a feasible governance scheme and a funding strategy in order to guarantee the research infrastructure sustainability. Very important. Based on an early identification of in-kind and in-cash member states, including what they have prepared or invested in their smart specialization strategies, as I was told before, and how to use incremental interactive construction methodologies in order to continuously review and monitor an establishment or appropriate quality assessment and risk management plan for a realistic, feasible, and sustainable construction of this distributed infrastructure. So, in this regard, we have a very nice strategic plan. No, many, many pages, but we have translated this in a very nice construction intranet that have two main parts, the smart sheet for financial issues and another for technical, more ICT-oriented issues. And so all of this is related with some specific smart strategy, specialization strategies, for instance, from the Andalusia region, with this, where it is envisage that more or less 25 million euros will be used to this regard, to the construction, and from our side, from the Spanish Ministry of Economy and Competitiveness, we're talking about 45, more or less. And so the good news is that for the construction of the statutory seat premises, as well the coordination of this huge ICT infrastructure, this is LifeWatch is specifically mentioned in this Andalusia region, for instance, this example, smart strategy. Specialization and connected with some EGI, European Green Initiatives, transversal initiatives. So there are some other very interesting initiatives, such as Retiragro, the Portugal-Spain Network of Excellence for Biodiversity Preservation and Sustainable Development, on Iberian Agro System, the same from in between France, Portugal, and Spain, and I would like to focus on to remark a very successful initiative that has just finished last December 2014, when we have mobilized approximately 7.5 million euros for the updating, internationalization, and updating of the Doñana Singular scientific and technological research infrastructure for LightWatch. Of course, based in the structural funds, regional structural funds. Some conclusions, so 1 minute. Research infrastructures are important both for the progress of the European excellence in science and innovation, particularly those including the S3 roadmap, as well as for the development of the regional innovation strategies for smart specialization, RIS3. Of the territories that have been identified, then in terms of economy, high quality employment, and transnational cooperation, RIS3 as one of the ex-ante conditions essential as ante condition for the use of structural funds. Therefore, research infrastructures are important targets for both European, regional, and RTD and innovation policies to in turn reinforce cohesion policy. It was before also shown here. So we are talking that we must guarantee synergies, especially between these structural funds and Horizon 2020 funding instruments. European Commission and national authorities should set specific guidelines to the regional authorities interested in mobilizing these structural funds and investment funds in the construction of the operation of these S3s, and the creation of this new research infrastructure must be performed through an iterative and incremental, not reinventing the wheel, not starting from scratch, existing ongoing initiatives. That is the case in, of an ICT with EGI, with PRAISE, etc. So LightWatch is particularly relevant in the case of the involvement of some, and I will mention all of them, Andalusia, Extremadura from Spain, regions, Region de Puglia, Region of Auvergne, Region de Puglia from Italy, Region of Auvergne from France, Region of Sagar, Belentejo Central, Sestre de Porto Norte, de Portugal, Crete from Greece. And from this perspective, we are really happy to say that it is a distributed infrastructure where some regions are aware of its potential for capitalizing already existing investment, improving ICT developments that may be useful for biodiversity research and for other proposals, decision makers. And special attention must be to be expected, placed to be expected impact in the regional industrial sectors, small and medium companies. All of this in synergy with existing the open access and European open access, the European Open Science Cloud. Today there was an official event on to this regard, this very nice and exciting European Open Science Research. And in that sense, with LightWatch, we're trying to integrate the best practice to integrate virtual and virtual media through this, it's ERIC. However, and this is the last one, however, the implementation of research infrastructure will be a serious risk if the smart strategy policies are not taken into account. That is clear. We must establish realistic instruments and not being simple extension of preparatory phase projects, because we need to sustain them. Second, we need to create not new profiles, but a new adaptation of the existing profiles, research technologies, all of them of the, looking always for the future customers' requirements, these new profiles, professional profiles to deal with this. And at the same time, must be in synergy with the Digital Agenda for Europe, and more specifically with the big data and virtual research environments paradigms. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Juan Miguel. Thank you for your presentation. Now we go to the next one that is going to be presented by Jana Kollar. She is CEO of CERIC ERIC, the Central European Research Infrastructure Consortium. She had been Director General of Science and Technology in Slovenia, being in charge also of the structural funds allocated for R&D in Slovenia. She is currently a member of an expert body advising the Austrian Minister responsible for science and research. So the floor is yours.
Thank you. Should this work? Thank you. It's not linked to this one.
It's not linked?
No, it doesn't appear to be.
Control.
Ah, okay, thank you. Yes, hi. Good afternoon. Now, the presentation, the brief presentation, will start with a short introduction to Serik Erik. Now, Serik Erik is a distributed research infrastructure established as an Erik in Central Europe. Now, in 2011, in 2012, 5 European countries and Serbia came together and proposed to European Commission to establish an ERIC in the field of a distributed research infrastructure in the field of advanced materials, biomaterials, and nanotechnology. And this had been, done in 2014 with the Commission's implementing decision establishing Serik Erik. Now, Serik Erik brings together a number of member states, which you have presented here, with complementary equipment in the field of characterization of materials. Synchrotron radiation from Italy, Elettra, NMR, nuclear magnetic resonance from Slovenia, light scattering from Austria, surface physics from Czech Republic, synchrotron radiation, a different one from Italian source, provided by our Polish member. Then there's neutron beam lines in Hungary, microscopy in Romania, and tandem accelerator in Croatia. Croatia and Hungary are associated partner facilities. Member states have not yet joined with a partner facility. Now, the rationale for establishing this institution was, first of all, to optimize resources. Now, a lot of resources are invested Europe-wide, not only into large, single-sided facilities, but also in large and mid-scale laboratories, which need to be of top qualities in certain regions. Now, the rationale for Serik was that each country, participating country, looks at its landscape of research infrastructures and proposes the laboratory which would complementary fit to the ones of other countries in the field of advanced materials and would be of excellent quality as assessed by International Evaluation Committee, Assessment Committee, composed of expert researchers in the field. And this had been done. Now, we also wanted to optimize the use of research infrastructures. Several of the participating partner facilities have not had open access before. So in this way, we are providing a single access point with standardized, high-quality peer review, enabled to allow users from across the world to access these research infrastructures. By allowing also users from the best users, researchers from around the world, to work on these research infrastructures, we consider that there's significant benefit also for our members, because we do all learn from working with these brilliant scientists. Now, the third rationale was also to increase the quality of managing these research infrastructures and the quality of internal research. This is addressed through joint research projects and knowledge sharing in the case of, for example, technology transfer, communication, management of research infrastructures. Take note that Serik is a distributed infrastructure where some countries are really very well developed, for example, Austria, also Italy, while the other countries are more or less the ones from the widening group. Now, the funding for this Serik Erik is basically twofold. The funding for the central administration is provided by Italy, which hosts the seat of Serik Erik. Then each country has to fund its own infrastructure
prioritize it within their national landscape of research infrastructure and contribute it in kind to be able to host the users. It's very important that CERIC-ERIC started with the open calls even before it was established in 2014 with a pilot call. It had never had a preparatory phase or implementation phase funded by European Commission. So it's been running now since 2014, and we try to learn by doing. And on the way, try to establish all the necessary internal regulations and strategic documents to help us on the way. Now, in order to be best fit for also for funding of the with the structural funds, please note that several of the participating countries are from cohesion regions. CERIC commissioned a report in 2013 trying to investigate potentials for co-funding of CERIC-ERIC activities with the cohesion policy funds. The report broke down the needed the support per activity and tried to identify which funds are best, either national funds or structural funds. And within ERDF funding, is it national funding, cross-border, or territorial cooperation? And what is best left for the Commission, for example? Now, examples how this is implemented 2 years later are the following. Oh, yes, of course, since we were discussing smart specializations before, this report also emphasized to all the participating regions that they need to emphasize, include their research infrastructure which participates in CERIC also in their smart specialization strategies in order to have at least the possibility to fund the research infrastructure within the next funding period. The report was widely disseminated, and most of the countries have included explicitly CERIC-ERIC in their smart specialization strategies. Now, this was not all that difficult, as you might imagine, because the fact is that CERIC was established before the next the smart specialization strategies were prepared. But you should consider that, first of all, member states proposed their lab their facilities in which they were investing heavily also before, so they were prioritized also within the previous funding periods. And also, CERIC-ERIC addresses the field of advanced materials, characterization of advanced materials. I don't think you can find a smart specialization strategy in Europe which would not also address advanced materials because, well, it's a key enabling technology which goes across sectors. So unless you have a smart specialization strategy which solely focuses on services, you're likely to have also this kind of materials included, this kind of research possibility to include this kind of research infrastructure. Now, structural funds are now a reality, and the current situation is the following. Joint R&D activities are currently funded. We have a call that is published, internal call for research. It's co-funded by Italian national funds and with the in-kind contribution from all participating member states. Now, when it comes to members in Czech Republic, since their partner facility is included on the roadmap, infrastructure roadmap, as is the case with most of the CERIC partners. They are receiving national funds for operation and structural funds for upgrading their research facilities, research infrastructure. NMR Center in Slovenia is receiving so far, there is support for the operations from national funds, and no call for research infrastructures has been published yet. Solaris in Poland, it's a synchrotron. It was constructed with 50 million of ERDF in the previous funding period. Now a call is open to which it's applying for the upgrades of the research infrastructures. Microscopy in Romania, the infrastructure had been financed in the past with 80% of the research infrastructures covered with ERDF funds. Now, we have jointly applied for Central Europe to cover some of the activities related to TT, and cross-border ERDF is used by our partners for implementation of joint projects. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Jana, for your presentation. And we have reached the last one that is going to be made by Dr. Zlata Novotna. She's head of International Relations and Grants Office on CEITEC, the Central European Institute of Technology. She has a doctoral degree from the University of Veterinary and Pharmaceutical Science in Brno and a diploma in Marketing and Strategic Business Planning from the Czech Institute for Marketing in Prague. So you have the last 10 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you, Fernando. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. It's a pleasure for me to give a last presentation with such an optimistic title, Success Case. So I'd like to share with you several thoughts why I think that in South Moravia we have some success case, or at least better to say that we are on a good track to have a success. And with a success, I mean nothing less than having a good flourishing environment in the region, connecting excellent science and excellent innovations. I will focus very briefly on some history, and I will mention some challenges for future, and I will conclude with some key factors I believe important for the success. And I'd like to make my presentation as much practical as possible. So the first question, where is South Moravia? Of course, maybe you know it's in the Czech Republic. I do not have a map here, but if you imagine Prague being here and Vienna here, so Brno is on a halfway in between, but still closer to Vienna. So we border with Austria. And it's quite tricky because although we are in the Czech Republic, the Moravian people are like not typical Czech, and I speak not only that Czech people drink beer and Moravian drink wine. I mean that there is something special in the Brno environment, and I don't speak that in Prague you have a plenty of tourists and in Brno you have plenty of students, but something is on this. If you see the numbers, really in the region we have many universities, altogether 14, and we have 86,000 students in comparison with some 800,000 inhabitants in the real city. But what's more important, it's the and interesting, it's this R&D investment. We have the region puts 3.4% of regional GDP into R&D activities, including the infrastructure, and this is something already. And speaking about smart specialization, the region is a global leader in production of electron microscopes and IT viruses also. So what's behind this setting? And I believe it's the regional innovation strategies and the regional innovation center. The South Moravian region was the first ever region having in place the regional innovation strategies if we compare the countries of Visegrad area or let's say South Central and Eastern Europe. So we began with this innovation strategy in 2001. And the entity behind is the South Moravian Innovation Center, which is not only an entity providing business incubation to startups, but it's really some spirit behind all this endeavor, all this development, putting all best people on one roof to one innovation strategy. All these action plans have some concrete projects to be implemented. And an important thing is that we have a political commitment. So a crucial thing is having politicians on board. And here you see the main results of already three generations of regional innovation strategies. So I pointed out these strong R&D investments, and as Katia mentioned, this 5.9 billion euros, so some 700 million euros have been placed in the region. And again, I could read that we have all these high-tech jobs and all these new companies and research cooperation and so on. It's about having people going abroad to visit advanced region in Europe and then coming back and implementing the good practices that they learned abroad. So I can say that we didn't repeat any mistakes, really picked all the good ideas that were functioning in Europe and we try to implement. And here you see the first examples of these synergies. Some of the projects were financed by the region, some of them by the European Commission, some of them by the city of Brno. Now we have already fourth generation of the regional strategy, so-called smart specialization strategy, and you see that one of the pillars is excellence in science. Now I'm come to introduction of my institution, SEITEC. So thank you, Susanna, that you also mentioned in your slide. You see, we have a lot of links here, although we didn't coordinate our presentation in advance, really. But as was mentioned, SEITEC is a new emerging center of excellence, which combines quite interesting combination of life sciences, advanced materials, and nano and microtechnologies. You see a nice picture of the building of SEITEC at Masaryk University. This building or this institute's specialization is life sciences. And there is another building at the Brno University of Technology dedicated again to these technical disciplines. And you see our total budget, quite big, 208 million euros. This finished last year, so everything is successfully in place. And now we have to care about sustainability. If we speak about infrastructures today, so I can say we have 10 core facilities worth 100 million euros. So it's really state of the art. It's really very, very nice and attracting a lot of researchers from abroad. It was mentioned in the morning, it's a key point, as a criterion for having the center international. And these core facilities, you have some of them here in the field of life sciences, allow the researchers to investigate objects in all possible levels of resolution. So just briefly about the history. The first phase, as I mentioned, this was some preparation of regional innovation strategy. And the key point is that we were able to reach some regional consensus among all the six partners. In the second phase, we had to build all the infrastructure. And this is first examples on concrete synergies, how we combined various funds. including EADF Fund, European Social Fund, and also the Seventh Framework Program, Horizon, and ESFRI. So we are involved in all these schemes. We try to be constantly in the field, speak with the researchers, and get to know their needs. Because if we know their needs, then we know how to combine the various sources of funding. If we speak about synergies, we must also mention complementarities. And indeed, it is important not to double fund things, but to find complementary funding. An example is here the SATEC project funded by European Regional Development Fund, and this was money for the, like hard money for the equipment with Silica, which was a capacities research potential project that financed some HR development and international conferences and so on. The third phase currently is in place, so we have to care about the sustainability, as I mentioned. And for this, we have as a main source the National Sustainability Program. It's provided by the Czech state budget. We have also National Roadmap on Research Infrastructures, which, as was mentioned, finance the operation of the infrastructure. And we have also other new operational program, which hopefully will bring some money also for like, soft money for human resources and international activities and so on. But mainly we have to focus on Horizon 2020. And the reason is a very clever idea and tricky idea of our government that each euro we receive from National Sustainability Program must be complemented with 40 cents from Horizon or other external sources, meaning external from a central state budget, or from a contract research. So this is very ambitious. It's like 40% of co-financing. And really, we have to put a lot of effort on this in future. For this, we make a lot of effort for having a good partners. And you see some of logos of our partners, strategic partners. We are in the S3 project. We are members of EU Life Association as the only institution from new member states. So we are very proud on this, and I personally believe without this work on the international level wouldn't be any success possible. SATEC achievements, just shortly, I'd like to point out the successes in this widening participation and spreading excellence scheme, because we have one ERA chair grant and three twinning projects. It's quite a lot, really. We were also surprised that out of five projects located in the Czech Republic, three are now at SATEC. So we can continue our strategic partnership with EMBL or with Grenoble University and so on. And of course, we are very proud having first two SATEC ERC grants. Probably for you, it's not so big issue have an ERC grant, but believe me, it's something for Masaryk University and for SATEC. And of course, the goal is not the grants or the projects, but the goal is the excellent science. I'd like to summarize the key success factors. It's really a political commitment on the regional level. It's about results orientation. So first, know what we want, what we need, and then to find some source of funding. This is very important. Having best people on board, I think that all of us can have such slides or prepare such slides because all of us have experience, both good experience and also bad experience, which, by the way, is also a good result, having a bad examples. Okay, we have to be constantly in the field, as I mentioned, and I would like to finish with the last point that we have a professional grant support. I speak as a head of a grant office at SATEC, and really the service we provide to researchers with preparing grants and managing grants, it's one of the most appreciated. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks a lot, Zlata, for the presentation. We have run out of time for the debate, but I think that we should have 10 minutes extra for questions or comments before to go to the coffee break. So any comment, any question from the audience there in the right?
Good afternoon. My name is Svet Stavrev. I work for the European Organization for Nuclear Research, CERN. And I have a question to Katia. So, is it possible that EU member states, which are members of a European infrastructure, but are not a host country, let's take the example of European Spallation Source, the EU member states, which are members of ESS, apart from Sweden, that these countries mobilize and use European structural funds for support to the project? That could be in the form of in-kind contribution, for example, let's say manufacturing of components and equipment during the construction phase. If that is theoretically possible, how you can put it in practice in the current programming period? Thank you.
Yeah. I remember that question had been asked before in writing, and I suppose you know the answer. It's very, very difficult to do that because CERN is outside the EU territory in parts. And structural funds, with the exception of Interreg, but which has its limitations, as has been pointed out, structural funds can, in that sense, the building up of endogenous potential only be used within the EU territory. So Switzerland not being part of the EU.
You said in your presentation that it's not necessary for the money to be spent necessarily spent in the country as long as it is for the benefit of the country. So in this case, the equipment and the manufacturing will be done in the country, although, of course, it may be shipped and used elsewhere, but still for the benefit of the country.
Thank you. I didn't quote the relevant article of the ERDF regulation completely. It says only within EU territory in that sense. What is possible, and there really WTO rules apply and there is no limit, is if a research institute within the European Union or a company or somebody wants to buy research services from outside the EU, that is possible. So service contracts are possible, but not the installation of fixed equipment there. That will be very, very difficult to construct, or actually I would, as a lawyer, intensively advise not to consider that.
Any other question? Any other comment from the table, the members of this table? If there is not, I would like to thank you all of you for your participation in this very interesting session. And I invite you to go to the same room in which we have the lunch for the coffee. And thanks a lot for your attention.
Sí, yo creo, bueno, aparte de que él está...